2021 officially completes my 20th year as a software engineer. 2001 was the year when I received my first ever paycheck as a software engineer. A lot has happened in these 20 years. I've lived in 2 different countries, 6 different cities, earned 2 software engineering degrees, and worked at more than a dozen tech companies, from obscure startups to the biggest tech giants. Not to mention, I also failed in school, got rejected by over 60 different companies, and also got laid off. But I also managed to land some pretty awesome job offers, co-found multiple tech startups, and also start a successful software engineering YouTube channel. So yeah, if you're interested in the 20-year software engineering journey of a random dude on the internet, then I suppose you've stumbled across the right video. Let's start by winding down the clock all the way back to the year 2001, where my software engineering journey first began. I was in 11th grade in 2001, back in my hometown of Kathmandu, Nepal, going about my business at school when I somehow got the opportunity to build a website for a bank. I had never actually built a website, so I had to grab a bunch of books from my local library to learn HTML and CSS. Thankfully, this was 2001, so websites were pretty basic with mostly static information. It took me about 6 months to deliver the final version, and for that, I made the equivalent of around $300, which is a lot of money in 2001 for a third world country like Nepal. So like any other poor kid would do, I used all that money to buy my first electric guitar. Even though it was just HTML and CSS, this was the first realization that I could actually earn money with some coding skills. In 2002, I was supposed to graduate high school, but I ended up failing high school. Yes, you heard that right. It was a mixture of young age, misguided ego, and a bit of a rebellious nature. I would spend hours on the things that I loved, like computer science and math, but just not care about everything else. And as a result, I had pretty high scores on those, but did pretty miserably on the rest of the subjects. But as 2003 rolled by, I quickly realized that being a rebel isn't going to take me anywhere in my career. And at that time, my country really did not have any colleges or opportunities for software engineering, so I wanted to study abroad in the US or UK. But then, because I had no high school diploma, that wasn't really possible. So I swallowed my teenage pride, took the year 2003 off, and self-studied all the boring subjects to eventually get my high school diploma. 2003 was also a pivotal year for me in terms of my growth of programming knowledge. Since I was studying on my own for my diploma, I had no school, which meant I had a lot of time. So I worked on a lot of random coding projects. One important web app I built was an online version of the Sudoku puzzle. The motivation behind this project was for me to learn how to solve Sudoku puzzles because I could not solve one to save my life. So I thought I would try to solve it with code. In the app that I had created, users could create a new game and once they're done, press a button to check whether their solution was correct or not. That was pretty straightforward, but the thing I could not figure out was how to actually solve the puzzle. So I reached out to my friend who was pretty much a genius in computer science and he helped me implement a Sudoku solver using backtracking. My mind was blown thinking how I had just written code that could solve any generic Sudoku when I still could not solve one by myself. I think that was the key moment in my life that really got me interested in the power and magic of coding, which started me on this journey of learning. I started reading more on backtracking, got into trees and graphs, then into search algorithms like DFS and BFS, and it was all just amazing for a 16-year-old kid who had all the time in the world. So I just soaked it all up like a sponge. In August 2004, I left my hometown and my family behind and moved all the way to the US to study computer science and mathematics in a small Midwestern liberal arts school. The next 4 years were pretty uneventful in terms of what I did around software engineering. I took the typical computer science courses, data structures and algorithms, algorithms analysis, computer graphics, web technologies, human-computer interactions, few calculus classes, probability statistics, linear algebra, discrete math, so on and so forth. The courses themselves weren't too challenging because thanks to my inability to solve Sudoku puzzles, I'd already learned all of the foundational computer science concepts. The more interesting part for me in college was everything else that is not related to software engineering. I took so many optional electives, classes on advanced composition, public speaking, management, economics, ethics, Brazilian history, fine art, world civilization, civilization, crusades, French Revolution, history of the United States, and so much more. Things that I would have probably never invested on learning by myself. But even more than that, I participated in many different organizations, made a ton of friends from the US and around the world. I even met my wife in college. But aside from that, I also managed to land an internship in San Francisco, which was my first ever time in a big city, let alone Silicon Valley. I grew up watching movies that showed the iconic Golden Gate Bridge, but it's one thing to watch it on TV and another thing to live just half a mile away from the Golden Gate Park and take a jog there every evening. These years in college taught me to become open-minded and genuinely learn about people from different walks of life, different places, different ideas, which I think helped me in my life as much, if not more, than my engineering knowledge. In 2009, after I graduated from college, I applied to a bunch of companies, 53 to be exact, and forget rejections, I didn't even hear back from a single company. Just because I had a degree and I knew computer science, I probably expected these companies to hand me jobs, but that was far from reality. It was a bitter moment where I realized that finding a job isn't a matter of just being smart or getting a degree. It requires preparation and planning. And since I didn't have a proper job lined up, I decided to take a year off and attend grad school. As a stopgap, I found an opportunity to help a small school district build a content management system. But that job alone wasn't enough to cover my rent, and I also needed to save some money for grad school, so I had to take a second job at Geek Squad. In addition to that, I also had to prepare for my GRE because most of the grad schools that I was applying to needed a very good score in order for me to qualify for scholarships, without which I wouldn't be able to afford grad school. So 2009 was pretty lame. Full-time as a consultant at a school district building a content management system, full-time in a second job at Geek Squad, and pretty much another full-time job preparing for the GRE. Thankfully, I got accepted and received both the teaching assistantship as well as the academic scholarship. My grad school was in Chicago, so I packed my bags and moved there in 2010. Graduate school was my first taste of distributed systems, which, if you follow me in LinkedIn, you know is the bread and butter of my career today. I studied a lot of service-oriented architectures, event-based systems, redundancy, failovers, disaster recovery, and things like that, mostly using C#, Python, and Scala. Being a teaching assistant, I was also actively participating in preparing course materials for my professors, teaching classes, and grading papers. And one of the things I realized during this time is just how much I love teaching and mentoring. During my final year at grad school, I made sure I applied to jobs properly this time around. So instead of blindly sending job applications to a zillion companies, I was more selective and deliberate. I received a few offers in 2012 and accepted my first official software engineering position at Epic Systems, one of the largest healthcare companies, if not the largest. It was a dream scenario to be able to have a great job at hand even before graduation. However, that honeymoon ended pretty quickly once I realized that the position was not really what I expected it to be. And I think the company was super awesome with amazing perks, but they had made a decision to put people on technical leadership roles based on sales numbers instead of engineering acumen. At least that was the experience in my org. And since mentorship is hugely important to me, I decided to leave the company. I eventually ended up taking a position as a software developer at a startup in Chicago for about 20% less compensation because I loved the team and the projects they were working on were super interesting. I had an amazing manager there, and one really cool project I got to work on end-to-end involved supervised learning. The basic idea was to scrape local restaurants for any offers and deals and show those deals in our application. Since our app already had traction, it would give the small businesses visibility and we'd make a small commission out of it. To streamline and automate the whole process, I wrote some Bayesian classifiers that would attempt to detect offers and deals from the script content. We had a few content managers who would validate or invalidate those classifications, helping train the model. After a few months of training, my model was classifying offers with a pretty high accuracy to a point where we were generating offers on our site without much human intervention. It was not a very complicated project per se, but that was my first experience at taking a high-level idea and building an entire data pipeline end-to-end with supervised learning. So in that sense, I think it was pretty cool. Startups are a great place if you want to learn things quickly and be exposed to the entire stack in software engineering. They may not have the perks, compensation, or the job security that bigger established companies have, but the learning at startups happen at an accelerated level. But that being said, in 2013, my startup exuberance ended in tragedy as the parent company lost a lot of high-profile clients and the entire startup division was axed, which means I got laid off as well. At this point, I made a decision to move to the West Coast. So I took a few months off, did a bunch of interview preparation, and applied to Microsoft, Amazon, and Google. I got rejected by Google and went all the way at Amazon and Microsoft, eventually accepting an offer from Microsoft. A month later, I sold all my belongings for the past 10 years and flew across the country from the hustling, bustling Chicago over to sleepy, foggy, and incredibly beautiful Seattle with my three-month-old German Shepherd and just two suitcases. I started at Microsoft towards the second half of 2013 as a software engineer one, and mostly spent my time working on improving internal tools and services. As an entry-level software engineer, you aren't really contributing much, especially at a big tech company. A lot of your time is spent working on a variety of projects so that you get the opportunity to learn and grow as a software engineer, so that when you eventually get to level two or level three or senior, you have the right set of skills to make bigger impact. That's basically what I did for most of 2013 and 14. During those years, I mostly used C++ and C# and a lot of internal frameworks. 2015 and 16 were the craziest, but probably the most amazing 2 years of my entire career. In 2015, I was already software engineer two at Microsoft, and this was the beginning of a few years where I grew the most as software engineer. At work, I had an amazing manager, some epic mentors, and an awesome team that got to work on the entire stack, start to finish, on some incredible service-oriented projects. I learned so much about software engineering best practices, system design, service-oriented architectures, logging, caching, design patterns, refactoring, you name it. But not just that, I was also working on creating my own startup with a few friends. So I was basically at work for 8 to 10 hours, came home, spent about an hour with my wife where we ate dinner and took the dog out to play. Then I worked another 8 hours for the startup, slept for maybe 5-6 hours and repeated it all over again. No breaks, no weekends, no vacations, no Thanksgiving, no Christmas. This was my life for almost 2 years. But at the same time, the learning was also on steroids. I was working on so many different technologies: Python, Django, C#, Angular, Ionic, PhoneGap, Xamarin, Azure, SQL, MongoDB, and ton more. And all that hard work eventually paid off, because in 2016, we finally got funding for the startup with a valuation of about $5 million. During 2017 and 18, I was a senior software engineer at Microsoft. This is when I got to lead projects end to end and not only design the architecture, but also anticipate future changes to influence the design accordingly. I worked across teams and organizations on more critical, higher pressure, but higher impact projects that dealt with much larger scale. During these years, I also spent a lot of time reading and researching about principles and best practices for good design, because as a senior software engineer, your job is a lot more ambiguous. It is up to you to figure out what the problem is, why it exists, or how it can be solved. You need to identify the motivations behind it, costs, timelines, risks, and trade-offs. Leading the actual implementation of the code is only a small part of what I was responsible for. In 2019, I took the role of a software engineering manager. I had a phenomenal team and some super cool projects that we worked on, including redesigning the entire build, deployment, and integration pipeline of a very big product. During that time, I also realized just how much managers do to shield their directs from politics, unnecessary interrupts, boost their confidence, help them with their problems, issues, make sure they're in the right mental health, they're happy, compensated well, and promoted deservingly. And because of this, managers usually have very little time to invest directly on the engineering side of things. While I love the management side of things and spent most of 2019 focused on learning to become a good manager, deep down in my heart, I loved getting my hands dirty with the engineering side of things even more. So when the moment was right, I switched back to being a software engineer, acting mostly as a technical lead. Towards the end of 2019, I want to try something different. So I switched to a node-based stack. I was working on redesigning the backend of a project to make it completely serverless. And that's when early 2020 happened and COVID hit and everyone started working from home. I'll be honest, I'm not very good at being by myself. I love being around people, so I think that sudden switch to working from home was a bit tough for me. At that time, I also felt that I was yo-yoing from project to project, but doing very similar things, and somehow that learning had slowed down. I felt like I was starting to get complacent. It almost felt like I had stopped loving software engineering. So I quit. So for the most part of 2020, I spent time rediscovering myself. Since travel wasn't really an option, I basically picked up a lot of hobbies and read a ton of non-technical books. In fact, part of that doing something different also gave birth to this YouTube channel. I had no plans of ever starting a YouTube channel, but one thing led to another, and towards the end of 2020, I found myself scrambling to learn everything I needed to start a YouTube channel. How to write scripts for a video, how to use lights, how to shoot videos, how to color grade, edit, create sound design. And one incredible resource that was really helpful in me learning those skills rapidly was Skillshare, who also kindly sponsored this video. Look, I get sponsorship requests from all over the place, from vacuum cleaners to serial key discounts to random no-name USB chargers. But there's a reason you don't see all those sponsors in this channel. It's because I only work with businesses and services that I genuinely believe in. I have repeatedly worked with Skillshare because I deeply value the idea of continuously learning new things, even if they are outside your main skill set. And I have personally used many classes from Skillshare to learn how to successfully run a YouTube channel. If you're not yet aware of what Skillshare is, it is an online learning community for creative and curious people where millions come together to take the next step in their creative journey. They offer thousands of inspiring classes for lifelong learners on a variety of topics, including web development, design, freelancing, music, and communication, to name a few. There are classes for every skill level, whether you're a beginner or a pro. And one of the best things about classes on Skillshare is that they have no ads and they're just under 60 minutes. So it's easy to fit them into your schedule, even if you're a very busy person. When starting my own YouTube channel, I took the class Color Grading for Filmmaking by Dan Dan Liu, which was incredibly helpful for me as it helped not only understand the process of color grading, but also the science behind it. And I hope that it already reflects on the quality of my videos. And throughout 2020 and 2021, I've taken many other classes from Skillshare on lighting, talking to the camera, writing good scripts, so on and so forth. But if you're not into video or YouTube, that's okay, because they have tons of classes on literally any topic. So if you're interested in developing your curiosity and growth mindset, head over to Skillshare. The first 1,000 of my subscribers to click the link below will get a free 1 month trial of their premium membership. And finally, we are at 2021, which saw my channel grow even more thanks to all of you. I try to stay honest, grounded, and not give you short-term snake oil advice on this channel, and it appears that people generally appreciate that. The irony of it all is that I quit my job in 2020 thinking that I had lost passion for software engineering, which somehow led to me starting this channel dedicated to helping others become passionate about software engineering. And through the process of making these videos, doing research, interacting with you, answering your questions, I somehow became passionate about software engineering again. So in early 2021, I took out my dusty old data structures and algorithms book and started prepping for job interviews again. I interviewed at a few places, got a few offers, and eventually chose Microsoft again. So now I'm back at it, working at Azure with the puppy dog excitement about learning new things, with a completely new set of scalability and reliability challenges in completely different stacks and technologies than what I was used to. Things like Node, React, GraphQL, Rust, Go, and so much more. And that's it. Here we are at the end of 2021, and I've officially survived 20 years of software engineering. As you have seen, some days were tough, other days were not, but overall it's been a lot of fun, and I'd like to believe that I did okay. A career is a fluid and dynamic thing. I know that there's always pressure to have the perfect career, but I encourage you to take my example as a reminder that it does not have to be perfect as long as you eventually reach where you want it to be. Mistakes will happen, luck will not be on your favor, and you'll feel like a failure. And that's okay, it's normal. That's what makes us human. One of my managers once told me, failure is inevitable, and someone that has failed multiple times is much better equipped at handling that inevitability than someone who has never failed. Also, software engineering is not just about sitting on a fancy chair and coding for 8 hours a day. Much more goes into being successful in software engineering. Things like interpersonal skills, relationships, networking, your ability to disambiguate vague scenarios, leadership, communication, also politics. And sometimes, as the case was with our startup, just pure grit and hard work. So invest on those character traits as well. But if you want to take one thing away from this video, I want you to take this advice. If you want a fulfilling career as a software engineer, or any other field for that matter, one that you want to feel proud and accomplished about, you cannot stop learning. You gotta keep those gears spinning. You gotta keep that curiosity alive. If you stop learning, you stop growing. And you stop growing, you're done. So don't let your mind atrophy and don't get complacent. Learning should be the one constant in your life that never changes. Well, with that said, I wish you all a very happy holidays. Thank you for all the love and support you've given to this channel in 2021. I genuinely appreciate it. Stay safe and party responsibly. I'll see you in 2022. Cheers.